talk on the art and science.
Thank you. Is this working, the microphone? Well, it is certainly a great pleasure for me to be here today on our Blaine's 60th birthday. Well, I must confess that it only enhances a greater ambition because a few years back at MSRI, we gave an 80th birthday conference where Kaplansky and his thesis advisor, Saunders McLean, came to that one. So I hope we're all here for the next big one for Blaine. I was asked if I was planning to tell any stories about Blaine and his graduate student days. But from my point of view, the good news was he was my very first thesis student, and you don't get many like that. And the bad news was he was my first thesis student, and you just don't get many like that. It's like if your first baby sleeps through the night right away and eats beautifully and so on, you think, oh, that's what having babies is like. That's how it does. Anyway, the really nice thing is that when he was finished as a thesis student, it was by no means the end of our relationship. We've had many long years since then. I've been able to appreciate, as many people have mentioned, both his wonderful mathematical ability and his great personal warmth. And well, I'm saying these things not only because they're true, but because I'm counting on his good nature to apologize for this talk I'm about to give, which is really an offbeat kind of a lecture. And while I'm on apologies, let me apologize in advance for a couple of other aspects. One is, I have tried to pull together a whole bunch of things for this talk, and I was partially successful, but didn't quite get all the pieces that I was hoping to get together. Another is, I've spent years avoiding using technology. I've watched many talks go around and the computer went out or the pictures disappeared or whatever. The prize on that line was a couple of years ago, there was an annual meeting. I don't remember if it was either AMS or AAAS in Seattle. And they asked Bill Gates to give a talk. And he did, and they must have had easily 2,000 people in the audience. And he decided, of course, to use it to give demos of the latest developments in Microsoft. And both of the demos he tried to do failed. 2,000 people in Seattle. I was just picturing what happened when he got back to work. Anyway, this is my first time trying this, but I've got power with Andy, or some power right there. He's there, okay. So he set this up for me, and if it works, the credit is all to him. my last apology is that what I'm going to talk about is really not stuff that I played a central role in. My own role is, I don't know, it's either peripheral or seminal, depending on how you look at it, but it's not central. So anyway, this will all come out as we go along.
It's not true.
Okay. So I think what I wanted to do is start with the history, or really the prehistory of the problem, and go back to the beginning, maybe a little before the beginning. So before the beginning is an old, one of the first problems that came up when calculus was invented in calculus and variations. If you just hold up a chain and look at the shape that it makes, how do you find what shape it is and find the equation for it? And you can do it, I suppose, variation or tension, various methods. I don't know exactly who did it. I presume it's one Bernoulli or another. Anybody knows who first wrote down? The shape is called catenary, or a chainery. And it turns out that no matter how you hold it, it's always the same curve. It's a single curve up to scale. And it's simply the hyperbolic cosine curve, y equals hyperbolic cosine of a, But that is the curve, that is the calculated curve. And then, it turns out if you take that curve and rotate it around the axis, you get a surface called the catenoid, and thanks to Nietzsche's wonderful book, Always and Cuba, Minimal Pleasure, which I finally got hold of today, I was able to check what I thought was the case. This was first explicitly discovered by Euler in 1744, and it was apparently looking for least area for a surface of revolution. So he discovered the catenoid, and the catenoid, well, you start out with a chain, which is a piece of a catenoid, but once you have the equation, you have a complete surface. And the catenoid was the first example of a complete embedded minimal surface before there was such a thing as a minimal surface or embedded or completeness. That all came much later. The part of the story that makes Costa's surface so interesting is that it remained the unique complete embedded minimal surface except for periodic. The only one that wasn't periodic up until 20 years ago, I neglected to mention, this is also the 20th birthday of Costa's surface. So it's particularly appropriate also on this occasion. So for these many years since 1744, that was the only one. So let me briefly go through some of the history. Lagrange in 1762, when he was illustrating his breakthrough variational method for getting what we now call the Euler-Lagrange equations, wanted to give a two-dimensional example. So he said, suppose you take a surface over a plane domain with a fixed boundary and ask, what is the condition for it to have least area if you vary among all surfaces with that boundary? And he wrote down the Euler-Lagrange equation, which it turns out is not, he didn't write it in this form, but if you write it out, it's the second order nonlinear elliptic equation. And that's now known as the minimal surface equation. Now, things moved very slowly in those days. In 1776, Meunier looked at this equation and he discovered there is a solution which gives you the helicoid. And he also pointed out that this equation simply says, has the geometric meaning, that the mean curvature h of the surface defined by z equals f of xy is zero. This is the mean curvature up to a non-zero factor. So this gives it a geometric meaning. And ever since then, the word minimal surface has been used to mean a surface with mean curvature zero, whether or not it minimizes. Of course, this is a necessary local condition. Right? Then there was another long pause until Schurk in 1835 actually looked more closely at this equation and wrote down a whole series of solutions. Bill gave some examples and pictures, and I'll actually come back to that a little later. So after this, in another direction, Monge in 1784 noticed a very important connection between minimal surfaces and analytic functions. As Bill pointed out, minimal surfaces are characterized by the fact that the coordinates are harmonic functions on the surface with respect to the metric of the surface. Or equivalently, if you write the surface in conformal coordinates, they are harmonic functions of the coordinates. And this got used by a number of mathematicians, Weierstrass in 1866, and for 1864, Riemann, to give what is called generally the Weierstrass representation theorem, although as you can see, Hennepin got there ahead, and Riemann was dead by this time, so presumably he had done it first of all. then Hermann Amanda Schwarz devoted a huge amount of his career to working on complex variables approach and other things related to minimal surfaces. He has two volumes of his collected works, and one of them Now, one of the main reasons for the connection between complex functions and minimal surfaces, one of them is the one I mentioned about the coordinates. The other very important one, thanks for this picture from Bill, is the Gauss map, which is to say, if you parametrize the surface in conformal coordinates and then make the map onto the unit sphere, by at each point on the surface, you look at the normal and just translate that to the origin, and you get the map G of that point. And then if you project stereographically from the north to the south pole, you get a map into the complex plane, and the induced map of the parameters into the complex plane is a holomorphic map. It's because the Gauss map of the minimal surfaces is angle to surface. So this is another key reason why holomorphic functions play a role. Okay, now we move on to the, this was the 19th century. Enrico Giusti likes to refer to the 19th century as the century of complex variables. And to a large extent, that's true, and certainly in minimal surfaces, that was the major push. 20th century started out with a very remarkable paper by Sarah Bernstein, in which he proved that, in particular, if you take any solution of the minimal surface equation star that I wrote down before over the entire xy plane, it's got to be simply a trivial linear solution, ax plus by plus c. It's an absolutely remarkable theorem. There have been many theorems of the sort that bounded solutions of various elliptic equations and so on had to be constant, but no assumption of boundedness, growth, anything. Any solution, simply its existence, implied that it was this trivial case. And so this was a really quite amazing breakthrough. Geometrically, it simply says that if you have a minimal surface whose projection has a one-to-one projection on a plane, the surface itself is a plane. Very, very strong. Then along came a very important paper of Hopf and Renov in 1931, where they introduced the notion of completeness. The question was, what is a good way to describe that for any Riemannian manifold, you have the whole thing, nothing missing? You want to say, in some sense, it's complete. And they gave two different notions. One, they said, non-continuability. You can't continue it to something larger. So if you, for example, took a surface and took a point out, clearly not complete. Continue it to that point. But then they showed that was probably not the right one. And instead, they took completeness, which they gave four different equivalent definitions for, and it became one of the basic notions in differential geometry. And in particular, it's related to complete metric space, because if you simply define metric, turn it into a metric space by saying the distance between any two points, you look at all curves joining them, the Riemannian metric gives a length to that curve, and you, you look at the inf of the length of all curves between the two points and define that to be the distance. Points, it simply means it's complete in that measure. And this is equivalent to extensional geodesics. Well, the next important development in this particular part of the story was the Nirenberg conjectures. He was looking for the essential geometric content of Bernstein's theorem. So Bernstein was a theorem on PDE, but he said, well, perhaps you can get a more geometric way, what are the properties of a minimal surface that projects one-to-one onto a plane, and one of them will be complete, clearly will be a complete surface. And another property is the Gauss map. If you look at the normals, they will lie in a half, they'll lie in a half a sphere, if you take upper or lower normal. And so he said, well, maybe it doesn't have to be in a half a sphere, maybe it simply has to be in a neighborhood, maybe just omit two points, thinking of the Weierstrass and Picard theorems in complex variables. So he made these objective, maybe that's sufficient to turn it into a blame. And it turned out that one of those was right and one of those was wrong. The direct answer was somewhere in between. So when I was, this is about where I got into it, I started looking at political services from that point of view. And it occurred to me at the time that the really beautiful generalization of Bernstein's theorem, or the most powerful form I could think of, was the only known examples at the time of simply connected, complete embedded surfaces with a plane and a helical. There were no other examples. And maybe that's all. So the most beautiful theorem one could possibly get to contain Bernstein's theorem would be that the plane and the helicoid are the only two simply connected, complete, embedded minimal surface. And I never made a formal conjecture for the simple reason one had almost no information. There's no reason to believe one way or the other. As Bill said, the early knowledge of the topology of complete minimal surface was minimal. And there was very little to go on, but they'll also point out it looks like they're very close to getting it, and in fact, even Michael Rosenberg have proved, instead of assuming completeness, if you assume it's properly embedded, then indeed, this is the correct statement he's talking about too, and that in particular clearly implies Bernstein's theorem in a very nice way. So that's some of the background. And now this brings us up to from the prehistory to the history of the subject. There are four main references as far as the history here. And so I just want to go through and explain what these are. So first, what happened was, starting from Nuremberg's conjecture, what was needed was kind of a change of point of view. The original Nuremberg conjectures were based on the idea that certain restrictions on a surface, on a complete minimal surface, would require to be a plane. But instead of thinking of it that way, look at positively speaking. Suppose you have a complete minimal surface, what can you say about it? And so it's just turning around. So the Nuremberg conjecture about not being able to omit a neighborhood of a point simply can be put in a positive sense, that if you have a non-planar complete minimal surface, then the normals have to be everywhere else. At any rate, a key element in the study then, I was able to prove a global representation theorem. And this is like the Weierstrass or the various things called Weierstrass representation, except that this now applies to any Riemann surface in its entirety with any topology and so on. And there are three elements in it I call S naught, G, and H. So S naught is the underlying Riemann surface structure. Given any surface in free space, it has an induced Riemann surface structure, a formal structure, and I call that S naught. And then there are a pair of functions on S naught, G and H, where G is a meromorphic function and H is a harmonic function. So any minimal surface in our three non-plane, plane, like constant functions and complex variables, it's always the exceptional thing. The plane is the exception. For any non-constant, any non-planar one, you get a clear with this thought. So with certain conditions on G and H, namely that if you write down this differential omega in terms of local coordinates, then the zeros of omega are related in particular way to the poles of G. And a second condition on curves, the period condition, where the F of the period condition is the G of the rest of the series. And if you have this F and G and S north, then you can give explicitly a representation of the surface by this these formulas. And in particular, you notice the harmonic function H is simply the X3 coordinate. And so, as I say, the advantage of this over the earlier things, first of all, it's global. Second of all, these three quantities are all very geometric. S naught gives a topology and conformal structure of the surface. H is simply one of the coordinate functions. And G, as it turns out, is exactly the Gauss map that I referred to earlier. So the G is given this way by the Gauss map and stereographic. So all three of the quantities that occur are very geometric. So this was the global representation theorem. And some special cases, for a simply connected surface, then you can take S naught to be either the plane or the disk. And in that case, you don't have to worry about the period condition, it's automatic. Or for genus naught, it's a plane domain, and that simplifies physics a lot. You don't have to work with differentials, just holomorphic and meromorphic functions on the plane. Now, a particular important class of surfaces, of complete surfaces, were those of finite total curvature. And it turns out that for that class, you have a lot of additional conditions. First of all, the key one is that the underlying surface is very, very special. It's conformally equivalent to a compact surface with a finite number of points missing. So that fact is crucial in further study. And then the meromorphic function G corresponding to the Gauss map actually extends to be meromorphic at those points. So you are dealing with a meromorphic function on a compact surface, which gives you an enormous number of special properties. And then the function H must have either a pole-like or logarithmic singularity at each of the boundary points, Pj. And now conversely, if you take any triple at all, S naught, G, and H satisfying these conditions, that will give you a complete minimal surface of finite total curvature. So this is a wonderful correspondence between the analytic representation and the geometric class of functions. It follows from this description, well, there's one immediate thing, that the fact that G extends to a meromorphic function means that the normals tend to a limit at each of the boundary points, Pj. So as you go up to infinity, on each end, the normals tend to a limit, and you get a certain plane direction. And the other thing you can prove as a result of this is an inequality on the total curvature, the integral of the Gauss curvature dA over the surface S, that is less than or equal to 2 pi times the Euler characteristic minus k. K was the number of ends. Now, of course, there's the Cohn-Vossen inequality that says for any complete two-dimensional manifold, you have, without the k, you always have less than 2 pi chi. this proves that you never get equality in composite on a complete minimal surface. There's always this additional number that gets subtracted off. Okay, this brings me back to this second critical paper in the series. This was by Lucasio, Giorgi, and Bill Meeks on the topology of complete minimal surfaces of finite total curvature. This was the first really close look at what topological restrictions came out of these facts that I mentioned earlier about the global structure. And in particular, they mentioned two things. One is that in this inequality, you have to have equality. And in fact, they gave a nice geometric way of looking at the integral curvature in terms of an index at each end. That index has to be one at each end for an embedded surface. So for an embedded thing, you get equality. And the other is, for it to be embedded, as I say, the normals tend to a limit at each end. Well, they have to be all, and if you want the ends to be parallel, to be embedded and not cross, they're all going to have to be pointing straight upward. Well, two opposite directions. After a rotation, you can make it up or down, which means that the function g, the Gauss map, is either infinity or zero. So this was starting to narrow down on what the possibilities were for having embedded surfaces of this sort. Now, around this time, there seemed to be floating the conjecture that all these restrictions were going to end up showing you that really the catenoids, the known examples, were the only embedded examples. And so the big surprise was in Costa's surface, Costa's PhD thesis from 1982, which later appeared in this paper in 1984, he wrote down an example which satisfied all the necessary conditions that George and Nix had written down. And basically, the surface S naught is this elliptic, basically, surface characterized by the P function, a two-sheeted surface, standard elliptic function surface. And the Gauss map is simply some multiple of the W variable. and the height function H you get by integrating this 1 over z minus 1 times z plus 1. And the point they showed was you could choose this one variable rho, the multiple here, to make the period condition go away. You get at least an immersed surface. I guess I should say that the big problem with the representation theorem is it gave you an immersed surface, but it's virtually impossible from the equations to see if two different points are going to map on the same. To show it's actually embedded directly from the equation is very, very hard. So this was a candidate for a new finite curvature, complete embedded minimal surface, finite total curvature, but that's where it stood at that point, and he was not able to show it was embedded. And so this is where, again, I got in the picture in a certain way. One of the things I was able to turn up, to my great surprise, is this piece of paper here. And what this piece of paper is the following. I was at Stanford, and I guess Rick Shane was at Berkeley at this point. I went to visit him, and he said, oh, you should come and meet Lucasio Giorgi, who's visiting. So I said, great. And I went to talk to him, and he said, oh, you know, we've got this student Costa who came up with this beautiful surface, and it looks like it might be embedded, and he drew a picture on the board of what it might look like. And so I copied it down, and this is the Xerox, the Doc Costa. This picture and said, well, it might look something like this. So I copied this picture and I sent it to Dave Hoffman, who was just then getting interested in computer graphics. The and I said, hey, this is a perfect kind of a thing to use your computer graphics on, put the equations in and look at it, and you'll just see, is it or is it not it? That, of course, was a sign of my total naivete about computers and computer graphics in particular. It turns out you don't just put something in and show it. First of all, as I said, those equations end up basically, you parameterize. What you have to do is simply you write z as a p function, bias cross p function, it's on the square, and then w becomes p prime. So there were standard places you could look these up and put it in your computer, and it turned out, of course, they were all wrong. So after months, you had to just start over and write down the equations and get it all in. And he actually managed, I think it took about 6 months before he got the first picture. And that now moves me on to where I try to use this thing. So if you excuse the next technology thing, I'm going to move this over here.
So there are many, many others that grew out of this.
So here is the picture of the old Costa surface, the original one. And you can see why, I don't know if you can see at this stage, 20 years ago, it was very hard to see how this surface came together. And it interested all kinds of different people. So a sculptor named Ralph Carlson made a little model of the Costa surface. He saw the picture somewhere. That was in Science News when he placed it. And he made this little model, which David has in his house. And I asked him for a picture of it, but I haven't gotten it. But here you see he's sort of blessing the thing in a groove. And this is now the model, which is sort of life-size. There's the sculptor, Ralph Carlson, looking at the model. He brought it to MSRI, and it was sitting in our lobby for a while. And there's David again, pronouncing over the model. It then moved on to the Baltimore Science Museum, where you can see sitting among a lot of other, I guess this may have been like one of the pictures that I showed forever. This is some other kind of a ceramic model here, and there are pictures all around the world. So this exhibit, I guess, is the Baltimore Science Museum. And there's another picture, a big model. I actually bought two of these, and I understand they are now one of them is for sale. Anybody knows an institution that needs a good-sized Costa service, you can write them all to our science museum. Okay, so the thing that happened next, I don't know the order anymore. Somebody sent me a number of photographs of a bronze sculpture and said, thought I might be interested in it because it looks sort of like some complicated mineral surface. And it turns out that this sculpture is sitting in the Philadelphia Arboretum. And the sculptor's name is Robert Engman. Here's the end view. You have these three planes. There's a square in one plane and circles in the other two. And he just filled this out and made this sculpture. And I thought it was absolutely beautiful. We were actually in the market for a sculpture at MSRI at that point that we wanted to put outside. We were looking for something mathematical. So I went and visited Engman. He lives outside of Philadelphia. And we thought maybe we might get a bronze sculpture from him. But it turns out they were very expensive. A long time to take. Unfortunately, we didn't get one. When I visited him, he said, by the way, I have these little things that I made years ago. And if you look at them closely, it turns out, that's the sculptor's hand, he basically had the idea of Costa surfing. Just from sculpture, he came up, he started hammering things out, moving around. And I thought that was absolutely remarkable. And then when he saw the pictures, he also saw it later. He contacted me with another picture of that visual sculpture. So I just took all these pictures and sent them to David. Now, I had just been at visiting the group when David and Gang were at UMass Amherst. And here's another sculpture that Engman had. And this absolutely flabbergasted me because one of the pictures David had showed me was something that looked very much like the picture of church surface that that Bill showed in his talk. And let me here. It has these holes in two perpendicular directions, it's kind of a tower. And I remember right, what David showed me was something that looked like this, except the holes were getting bigger in one direction. He was looking for non-periodic things, smaller in the other. That was exactly this sculpture. that Engman had, who had again never seen, this is just a brand new thing that David began to do. So this whole thing I found out was important. At any rate, other sculptors were interested too. Here's a picture of David Engman, which is a little hard to make out, but somebody else who saw the picture in Science News, wasn't even a sculptor, took a bunch of packing tape and started with something like Costa surface, also dreamed up these other surfaces which were like the family of extended Costa surfaces. Our name is Sarah Miller. And so she had these, I think she would be interested in some of their old family. At any rate, out and go on to the next step here. This, in case you don't see it immediately, this is a future Costa surface. And this was at the annual snow sculpture contest in Colorado in 1999, where Stan Wagon and Leland Ferguson and some other people decided they were going to try to make a Costa surface snow and put it in the contest. And so this is where they started. And they started putting holes in it and digging away at it. And just show you, it looks like it started snowing as they went further on. And they kept at it. It looks like they went at it day and night. And gradually, out of that block, they managed to get something that was more and more like Costa surface. Close to the final one. A number of different pictures there. There are a whole bunch of websites. Needless to say, you go to Google and see what you find. There are a number of different websites that have, in particular, these surfaces. There's the sculpture again. So they're almost finished. And there's some kids looking at them. Berkeley and didn't know what to do with his picture on the cover of Science News and said, wonder if I could do this and stay flat. And it is not obvious, again, one could do it. And especially just for those pictures. And I guess those who, as soon as Jim Hoffman looked at that, he said, oh yes, that was before we had the parameters right. Because in fact, the two ends are not exactly symmetric as they supposed to be. The first picture looked like this. And here are some more pictures of that sort. Okay, and meanwhile, Jim Hoffman had not been quiet. One of the things I was not able to find was many of the early things he did. He comes up with the most ingenious ways of illustrating what the surface looked like after the first black and white unsuccessful ones. You may have seen one of my favorites is the following. He pictured free space tiled by cubes, which are alternately black and white cubes. And then he showed the picture on the Costa surface with the intersection of those cubes with that design. That's a spectacular picture, which I have somewhere. Anyway, he kept trying to illustrate the structure by looking at the Gauss map and pulling it back. So he looks at various stripes on the sphere and what happens when you pull those back to the Costa surface. And this gives you a very good way, if you want to visualize geometrically what is happening on the Costa surface. And then, of course, what better way to picture the picture pulled back from the sphere than the usual sphere we know? You just picture the globe with the map on it and pull that back, and you get something that looks like that. We also have a series of pictures of this sort. So, as I say, I find this the most remarkable story, and I'm sure it's not over yet, but I thought you'd enjoy hearing some of the aspects. But thanks a lot.
Getting this thing.